Hello everyone, welcome to my channel. So today I'll show you some essential tips about how to write a research proposal, how to conduct a research proposal. So my name is Dr. Jigal Hamza. I am actually a postdoc researcher. I am postdoc fellow. So let's show the content about what we are going to present today. So about the content, we talk about research proposal. Then the most important part of research proposal, that is a literature review, how to download some articles, how to read them, and how to manage them. And we also talk about some tips about how to manage your time. Then finally, we'll show that it's important to have some some tools, some technology when you start your research proposal. So this presentation is mainly for students that are in China for doing research based on our experience. So we try to share our experience about quantity research, especially PhD research or master's research in China. So this will also help some Chinese that are in foreign country, because you'll see that the style of proposal differ according to the country, according to university. So before presenting, let's do a brief introduction about me. So my research interesting is about workflow scheduling. The main idea about task scheduling, resource management. So I am also interested about distributed system, cloud computing, mobile edge computing, machine learning, deep learning, and security, and some cryptography knowledge. So I'm also review for some academic journal, for instance Journal of Civil Computing and Journal of Programming. So basically, I have experience in China about 6 years, because I did my master degree from 2012 to 2014 in China, especially in Wuhan, Hua Zhong Fantashui, mean Central China Normal University, where I did my master degree in software engineering. Then after that, I went back home to my country, that is Senegal. So I came back in China, in Nanjing city, in 2016 for continue my study in PhD, in computer science PhD. So I got my PhD degree in 2020 in computer science and technology. Presently, I am in research postdoc position in Nanjing University of Science and Nanjing University of Post and Telecommunication, where I am doing my postdoc research. So these are some of some of my publication that I did during my academic research, during my academic study. So I have mainly about 5 papers, all indexing in high impact journal and conferencing. So you can see, you can have more details about citation if you Google my name on my Google Scholar. So let's start by research proposal style. So mainly, as I say, research proposal style depend on countries and university also. So for instance, in most international university, if I mean international university, I mean university that like foreign university like UK, America, Europe in general. So basically the research content, the content of research proposal are in this way. So first you have white title, abstract, introduction, literature review, objective question, methodology, work schedule, chapter outline. This research proposal is when you start your research. Usually after 3 or 4 semester, you have to write a research proposal to defend it. So in China, this is how we did when we want to, when we are doing usually master or PhD degree. So you have to write a research proposal and defend it. So basically the same thing also in Europe or America or Canada, like foreign country. So usually the main idea of a research proposal. So here in this presentation, we are going to focus more about literature review, like how to manage, because this is the most important part when you start, when you just start a research, how you have to like choose a journal, how do you have to select paper, how you have to download and where to download paper, how to read them. So this is why this presentation is just focused on literature review. So we'll come in some presentation to explain a point by point how a title should look like, how abstract should look like, and all parts of a paper or research proposal, how you should write them and how you should you lead with them. So for this presentation, we just focus on literature review, then explain how you will handle this literature review. So the next part here is the research proposal of most of the Chinese university. So basically it's the same as I said, but there are some definition that they add in here, which is some, for instance, here in China, the main research proposal template of many university is in this way. First, they'll say the source of topic. So basically, this source of topic is mean like where you get your research proposal title, and the title, it is fund, research project fund, or is not fund. So you have to see which like the research that you want to conduct, if it is a funding or funding project or no. So basically it's the same like when it's just a title. So this is where you put your title, and how you select the title, and where you get the title, is it from a fund research project or no. So the second part is basically in international way, I mean in foreign continent that is not China, they will just say like motivation, problematic, how this work, this motivation, where do you get motivation from your like from your research proposal. So sometimes they will say characteristic, theoretical significance, and practical value of the topic. Basically it's just about motivation and problematics. So there's also the part that is existing research at home and abroad. Basically it's the literature review. But here in China, when you are doing that review you have to specify it, like this letter review you get it from like international conference journal or a local conference or journal, but usually you mix them so because you can find some paper that it is collaborate paper, for instance from China and another university from a foreign country. So you see the definition of the content is basically the same idea, but the keyword are different, the way they formulated. So for you that just start a research in China, you can get a confusion over this new keyword. So because when I start my research, I just download on Google some research template, but when I start doing something, my supervisor tell me it's not in this way. You have to follow this standard, and usually the university also provide it to you. And if your university didn't provide it to you, you have to ask friend or your international office or teacher, is there a template for our university or for our department? So, and you see there's one called main content key issue to be solved and expected innovation. This is like mainly like the keyword, like the key issue, like the problematic you want to develop and how you think you can do a contribution about it. Then now you focus on your method, research method and technical route to be adopted, like methodology. But here, you don't confuse methodology like standard technique to like for instance a method that is sometimes algorithm or optimization method. It's different to methodology, that is this methodology I adapt to conduct research or adapt to collect data. So here basically is your optimization methodology, algorithm, and your proposed what you have already proposed technically. So, and of course, work scheduling, then chapter outline. This is the template in most invest in China for the research proposal. So, let's go ahead to give more detail about this. Now, where to download academic paper? So, of course, you have can get download from Google Scholar. In China, you also have Shuishu. You can also from journal official website. Sometimes you need subscription from your university. Here in China, most universities have a VPN or are subscribed to some journal, so you can download freely many papers. This is why sometimes you see foreign friends that in your country or somewhere, they tell me, please can you download this paper for me, because for there in the place, sometimes if you are not in university, it is locked, you cannot download it, you have to pay. So sometimes some friend help some student to download some papers. So but before download, how to know that a good academic, how to know a good academic paper? Because you cannot download any paper. When you are new in research, you can see, okay, every paper you get, you just want to download but sometimes you can download some paper that are really not useful for you. So for downloading, first you can look at the journal impact. Sometimes you can see more the journal have if the journal have a more impact, it means that this journal is good. Then also the conference edition, if you want to download paper from conference, check, because if it's the new conference, it means that usually they are not very good, because you don't know how they are, how they will be evaluated. But more the conference are mini edition, for instance, you can see this is the third edition of the conference, how long the conference have been established. So this also it can be a very good way to select to download a paper. And also, but it is open access or traditional publishing. Is a thing, traditional publishing sometimes you don't have access, but if you are in China, in most most universities have access to those traditional publishing, and open access is free for everyone, you can download it. But you come back on them, open access, traditional publishing, which one is best according to your position? Because you can see some investment in China, most of them, so your supervisor will tell you, we don't want to you publish on open access. But the reason will come it in another presentation. How to choose a journal? You go for open access or traditional publishing. Then you have also to check the experimental and analysis data. Like when you see a paper, you check how the author perform a experiment, how they collect their data. So based on data, you can judge that this paper is good for your research, so or is not appropriate for your research. And also using now many journal also ask the author to share their resource data. So it means if they do experimental, you can access to the codes on everything, so that you can also do what you call reproducibility. Now this is a challenge for many journals. They are adopting what you call code reproducibility. It means it will help another one who try to read a paper, so that it will be easy for him to implement the same thing that the author have also implemented. So, but the most important things in China, if you want to download a paper, is to have to ask the recommended journal or conference by your university. Because as a student, the most important thing for you is to graduate. So if you publish or download a paper that is not in the list of your journal or conference recommending by your university, it's just you waste your time, because it will not allow you to index your paper. So in China, in our computer research field, since I'm computer science student, so we have what we call a CCF list. It means China Computer Federation list. In our computer science area, we have a list that is really respected in China, all Chinese university. If you publish journal that is in that list, is a good thing, or conference that is in that list. So each country, according to your university, you have some recommending journal or conferences. So you have to know which one your university recommend to you, because as a student, this is the most important for you. So it is very important. You have to ask friend or teacher, do you have a database for our university? Is requirement to graduate, where to get papers, where to get some recommending journal. So this is the most important thing for most students, to download paper recommended by their university. And also some other university rank. For instance, if you download a paper, you can see the author name. Some author are really a very well-known author, so they don't even sometimes accept their student to publish in low level journal. So they always advise their student to publish in top journal. So when you see a paper, you also have some time to check the author. Who is this author? How many papers the author have published? How many citations he has? It will help you to judge if this paper is good or no, so that you can download it and do whatever you want. So now, after you download the paper, how to read a paper? Basically, when you start a research for the first time, for the fresh, for instance, a master or PhD student, when you download, you just read from title to conclusion. You read the title, you read abstract until conclusion. So this basically everyone, usually even me when I start, is just how we read. But this is not a good way. Of course, it's not, there's not a standard. If you go to Google, you Google it, you go to read a books research book, there is not a standard way to say to read every author you try according to his own experience. So based on my own experience and based on some tips find on internet, it is better to after reading the title, you go directly to see the methodology of after you read the title, you have to read the abstract, then introduction. But the most important part of the how to read a like a paper is after the title, to read the methodology, the approach, the technique, the proposed method that the author proposed. If I say again, if I say method, it's not like methodology, which how you do to collect, like what the author proposed, what is his contribution. So this way, this is why you put the index the number four, method and approach. Because if you understand the author method and approach, you will get something from him. You will know what exactly is the contribution of the author. So this is how. But if you read from title, abstract, like ordering, how, like, it's not a good way. You sometimes just even boring, because you'll say, okay, this introduction is too long. But sometimes after reading the title and abstract, it is better to go directly to the methodology. Then now, when you finish reading the methodology, you can also come back to the introduction to understand the main idea. So then from methodology, you can try to see the experiment. And a big mistake that many fresh student, starting research student, did is to read relative work. Relative word is not useful to use. Why? Because you are trying to understand a paper that you download. So if you go to the related word to read, you will get more, like you'll get even sometimes confusion, because rather than trying to understand what you are reading, now you are trying to understand another idea from another author, even it is the same area. So it makes confusion. So this is why sometimes you have to jump the relative word. When you understand the present paper in front of you, then now after that you can try to go to relative word to see this work that you have read, understand now which is relative word to that word. But sometimes you will need to read some key relative word paper. Why? Because the author also cite it. He says it's based on this paper that you also proposed it. So in this way, you can go to read the relevant related paper, then come back to the author one. Because when you read more related paper, sometimes you get confusion, because you try to understand one paper, then you go to see another paper, then from that also you propose another, then you go to see another paper. So it means you will link many related paper. It's good to get that, but first you have to know the first one from which the contribution come. Then from that you don't have to read this recent paper, so you skip it. After understand that one, then now you can come back to this. But sometimes even you are trying to understand that one that you have reading is also related to another paper. So you see, this is why you have to link all related paper, then you select the first one. Of course, it will be like the first recent one that help the author to do contribution. Then after you understand that one, you come now to another one, you come to another one. So you see, for that you don't have to waste your time to read some related paper that is not related to what you want to understand. This is what you want to explain here in this part, how to read the paper. You just read a little paper that is related to what you want to understand according to your problem. So this is the way to read a paper. And when you're reading also, you have to get some note, like use Excel to take note or make a classification. We'll show you what the classification is. So the classification about this paper. So this is a simple way to do, like to take note about when you are reading a paper. For instance, even with simple Excel, you can make this table in Excel. You put the title of your paper that you download. You explain the basic concept of the paper, what the paper is talking about, what paper is talking about inside the paper. For instance, so this paper used the plane to do this. And the method algorithm approach proposed by the author, what method, which method they propose, which algorithm they propose, which approach they propose, and what's the advantage of this paper, what the disadvantage of paper, and how they conduct the experiment. Then now you put the reference. of the paper. So this is a simple way for someone to want to use a software to manage the reference. Of course, you will show some free and commercial software that you can download or buy to manage your reference. But this is simple with Excel, how to manage reference paper. Then now, after you download paper, you can put what you for instance, you first download one paper, you put one, the title of the paper. Why is this important when saving in your computer? Sometimes you can download a paper, then you save it in one part, then you later you forgot, you want to download it again. So you just have redundant paper in your desktop. But if you take your time, after download it, you take your time, you rename them. One, for instance, the first paper I download and the title of the paper. So next time, if you want to see if you have the paper, you just tap the title of the paper. You can easily find if it is on your desktop or not, rather than just going download, and you just get a redundant paper, and it will be just waste your time, and also your disk will be full for nothing. So now, how to manage reference? There's some reference management tools. For instance, this one is JabRef, is free, and there's one that called Mendeling is also free, but there's EndNote that is commercial. But you know, as many student, we just try to find a key or crack of this software. So anyway, you can find a friend, or even on my YouTube channel, I show some software crack that I just share. In my YouTube channel, you can find this software. Now, how to manage your time? In general, what works for one person might not work for another. What does this mean? The way I manage my time, because sometimes you can have a friend ask you how you manage your time when you are doing research, when do you study, when do you wake up, all depend on the person. So, for instance, me, I can work, I say, okay, I just start at the 9. Some people cannot start at 9, they sleep. Some people, they cannot sleep, they study. So it depends on how you, it depends on the person, it depends on the person, how and their environment. So, but there's some tips you can give, is like to start as soon as possible reading article. Because sometimes when you come in China or do research, you have some class. So you go to class, you get some credit, but same time every time to try to read at least one paper or one page. Just be accurate in reading. This is very important in research. Every time try to read something. Every time, if you don't understand does anything, just try to read something. At least I can say one article every day, but or half of article every day. Imagine if you read one article every day, it's been 1 month you have reading 30 article, you see. So if it's that in 10 months you have read about 300 article, so you see. And avoid to give more time for something that is not related to research. What you mean? Sometimes when you are in foreign country, maybe you can want to go to a club, you want to do some like social things, is okay, but not more time than what is related to your research. Of course, distraction is good. You can do sport when you are tired, go play football if you like football like me, do everything you want, but you have to manage your time. Don't waste more time for social or for just fun than for research. So this is my own advice and tips I will give for any student that in foreign country, because sometimes you think that you have time, and the research is very hard in the way that if you don't have idea, you cannot do anything. So, but if you have, you start early, if you got your idea, it will be easy for you and you'll finish easy. Then now you have time to enjoy, do whatever you want, get more fun. So these are some tips I can give. So, and there's some important thing also is when you start a research, this happened to many students. They have just ready, they have ideas, they have everything. They add everything in the like they get every most ideas, they write the paper, but now they come back to the simulation part. They don't know how to perform simulation because they don't know any tools for simulation. if it is social science or engineering science, there is tools for simulation, because paper without analyzing, without simulation, you cannot see the contribution of your paper. So this is why when you start writing research proposal, don't wait until you get idea to try to learn technology. According to your tools you use, you have to start using them. For instance, if you don't know which tools you use, you ask your supervisor or friend, I'm doing research on this, which tools I will need. For instance, for those social science, most of them use SPSS to do analyze, to analyze the collecting data, to do some experiment or that. You see, those who do designs, they use, for instance, AutoCAD. Those who do GIS, they use, for instance, ArcGIS. You see, and MATLAB is used for many students, students. So you can see also to learn according to your research. And if it is programming language also, every time try to learn, even at you code one line is okay, also you learn. So, and this is skill especially for computer science student, you have to learn programming language to help in your career, because even academic, you cannot do academic research without knowing programming or something. If you want to work in industry also, they will ask you about knowledge about one, at least one programming language or one tool. So these some tools, maybe in my YouTube channel also I have to about Python, because one I use, so I'll try to do more present about the tools that I know. So these are some tips you also have to know when you start a research. And also try to reproduce what we call like experiment of methodology of analyzing of your key related paper. For instance, when you have downloaded a paper, try to perform the same result. Like if you read the experimental part, you also try to do the same experimental part to get the same result that the author did. So where to download those technical tools? Some universities, they have a server you can download from there, or from the lab, or classmate or professor can give you, or website. For instance, this website, you can get some academic tools of this website. And for instance, from paper that you cannot download, there's many academic links that I will try to share more links in the description, so you can download a paper or tools from there. So there's also some like important tools you have to know. For instance, that is origin for data analysis and graphing. I also have the software I can share in the link of on some link of my channel, or you can send me email, then a message, like you can comment it, I can share it with you. There's also plagiarism that I have read in my YouTube channel. There's what you call DRAIO, for instance, is a diagram software for making flowchart. It's easy, it's like a Microsoft Visio. So these also are very important to know, because sometimes you can see in your thesis, especially those that use Microsoft Office, you can try to draw something, but if you are not good in it, you'll see the graph will just, you'll get problem to manage even simple table. So you'll see how this tools is important. Also DRAIO is open source, also you can easily install it. Or this I will come to show you how to install it on your PC and how to use them. For plagiarist, I have read it, the video, you can check it. So the next video, we try to focus on reference management tool, that is JabRef, like how to manage JabRef for your references. Is easy and very, very, very important to manage your reference by using software like Jabber, because it's open source and is also is mean it's free. Open source means that is free. So in the next video, I will show you how to download, install, and try to use it. So you see here is the reference management tools. Jabber is the reference management tools. So if you like this video, please don't forget to subscribe to my channel and like it. Thank you for watching my video. See you.